Okay, so I'm Larry Holzman, and as people are logging on, we're going to wait about another minute or so and then get going. So welcome and thank you for your patience. Okay, I think we are going to get started now. I want to welcome everyone who has logged on, and those who are about to log on won't hear this, but welcome and good evening. My name is Larry Holzman, and I am the president of the Board of Jewish Family and Child Service. Of the roughly 100 Holocaust survivors in the Portland area, Jewish Family and Child Service's Holocaust Survivor Program currently assists 80 survivors with home care, hot meals, emergency assistance, and other forms of support, such as dental work, adaptive equipment, and case management. The majority of the funding for these services is paid for by the German government's claims conference, but our community is responsible for making up the difference in what it actually costs to run this critical program. Jewish Family and Child Service is proud to partner with the Oregon Jewish Museum and Center for Holocaust Education to co-sponsor tonight's program with Chamber Music Northwest and Ruth Bolliger, a Holocaust survivor, as we recognize Genocide Awareness and Prevention Month. This event is part of a series that is co-sponsored by the Immigrant Story, Oregon Historical Society, Oregon Jewish Museum Center for Holocaust Education, Never Again Coalition, PSU Holocaust and Genocide Project, and World Oregon. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Amanda Coven, Director of Education for the Oregon Jewish Museum and Center for Holocaust Education. Amanda holds master's degrees in education and Holocaust genocide studies and worked as a classroom educator prior to transitioning to museum education. In the 2.5 years Amanda has worked at OJMCHE, she has written the learning concepts for SB 664, which is Oregon's Holocaust and genocide education mandate, and increase the museum's outreach to support educators and students in the implementation of the mandate. Amanda?
Thank you so much, Larry. Hello, everybody. Welcome tonight. I am so thrilled to be in conversation with Ruth tonight. I've had the pleasure of working with Ruth for the past 2.5 years, and I've gotten to know her quite well. So how the next 25 minutes is going to work is I'm going to ask Ruth some questions I've been dying to know answers to, some that I already know the answers to, but I want all of you to know as well. If you have any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat or put them in the Q&A box, which you will find at the bottom of your screen. After the 25 minutes, we'll have about 10 minutes for Q&A from all of you, which I will moderate. But for right now, Ruth, one, how are you doing tonight?
Well, I'm glad to be here.
Awesome.
I'm really interested in how this is gonna go.
All right, so I'm wondering for people who have never heard you speak before, who don't know you, I'm going to give you the impossible task of summarizing your experiences and your family's experiences during the Holocaust, if you could, in 5 minutes or less, if you think that that is something you can do, but just to give people an idea of who you are and what your family experience is like before we dive into some more specific questions.
Right. So, I clicked a button that I wasn't supposed to click. So I am what is now being called a child survivor of the Holocaust, which means anyone who was 16 or younger when the war ended in 1945. And my story is really at least as much my parents' story. And we were essentially in flight and in hiding one way or another, or both ways at the same time, for the first 3 years of my life. It's a somewhat more subtle story than those of some of the survivors I know, A, who are a little bit older and have their own memories, and B, perhaps had a lot more dramatic instances happen. There are hardly any child survivors that I've been aware of anywhere who were actually in the camps. There are adult survivors, and I know many of them, but not many child survivors. And you probably know that about 1.5 million children, Jewish children, of course, were murdered during the Holocaust. So when I speak in the schools, what I don't know if you can see this.
Yeah.
It's just a funnel. And the larger part of the funnel is adults. And then the stem is child survivors. And you probably can't see that at the very, very bottom, it is yet a little bit narrower. And to me, that represents those of us child survivors who were too young at that time to have our own memories. My first memory occurred when I was 3, but we had already escaped Europe altogether. We had not yet made it to the United States. And if there's time, I'll tell you that part of the story. And so we were in, I don't know, I've never really counted, 4 or 5 countries.
5, I have counted, it's 5.
It's 5 countries. And, you know, since the story is one of flight and hiding and all pervasive terror among the people who did know what was going on or might be going on, what we were trying to escape and would our number come up before we were deported or any of that, the effects on me have also been more subtle than it would have been on an adult. Is that about 5 minutes?
Oh, well, I want you to start off by saying where you were born. So tell us a little bit about Czechoslovakia and then a little bit about your flight and escape. And especially one thing I think that's really interesting to your story is the role that like luck played. And I know for me as a math person, I really struggled in my schooling with the concept of luck.
Okay.
To me as a math person, like luck was the small statistical probability.
Right.
But within my studies with the Holocaust, I've really had to grapple with and understand and appreciate how much luck had to play with survival.
All right, so I was born in what is now called the Czech Republic. At that time, it was the part of Czechoslovakia called Bohemia. So you are listening to actually a real Bohemian, for what that's worth to you. My father was born, raised, and educated in Prague, and my mother was Austrian. And I was born about now an hour or so northwest of Prague, very near Terezin, as it happens, the concentration camp, which was not yet a concentration camp at that time. We moved around a lot beginning about when I was 4 or 5 months old. And my father was a very good man, a very smart man, and a very pessimistic man. I often say that I grew up under a gloom and doom pessimist on my father's side. That's not always good, but there are several times that it saved our lives. So I've always had to balance that when I think of him. We went from where I was born into Prague because my father already saw what was going to be coming in. He didn't know when, but he knew that Hitler was not going to keep any promises about not invading. So we went to Prague, which is technically not in Bohemia, although it was Czechoslovakia. The issue was that my father could go into Prague because he had been born there. My mother, being Austrian, was not born there. And I, being born in, it's called Ústí nad Labem in Czech, was also not born in Prague. So as a Jewish baby, I wasn't allowed in either. And so my father went in, and my mother ordered not a moving van as we know it now from Beacons or wherever, more a truck like FedEx or UPS or what, but it moved furniture. Usually if you go on a flight, you don't take your furniture with you, but she ordered that truck, had some furniture loaded into it, and then she hid under the furniture. So the driver knew that he was taking some furniture into Prague, but he did not know that he had another person on board. And in the meantime, I was taken into Prague on the arms of my mother's Czech language teacher. Being Austrian, she spoke German. She also spoke French and English by then, but not Czech. And so did I say German? It was her Czech language teacher who took me into Prague as her baby, which was no big deal, but my mother had to smuggle in. So the first piece of luck, or a piece of luck in any case, is that on that day, at that time, at that entry spot into Prague, the truck was not searched. It could have been, and had it been, I would either have grown up without a mother or a very different mother than the one I had. So that's one piece of luck. And from there on, we were in Prague for a while, needing to get out of Prague. And as Jews, not being able to travel without a series of visas and so forth. So I'll tell you another little piece of my family story. And let me tell you before I even say anything about it, it is not genetic. So my mother's father, my maternal grandfather, was a physician doing research. And in 1936, and bear that year in mind, Hitler was already in power but had not yet invaded. He won the Nobel Prize for an experiment that proved what needed to be proven and had not been. And if you've never seen, there's a diploma you get, which everything that looks like gold on here actually is gold. And I've seen one or two other Nobel diplomas. They're entirely different because they're done for each recipient and their field. The reason I'm telling you that is that one of the things that happens when you get a Nobel Prize is that there's a huge state dinner in Stockholm. Kings, queens, prime ministers, cardinals, that level. And my grandparents must have been sitting either next to or across the queen at that time of Belgium and her consort, who said to my grandfather, apparently, and I heard this later, of course, if I can ever help you, I hope you will let me know. So fast forward to 1938, Hitler invaded Austria. He didn't really have to invade much. They didn't resist. And my grandparents and their kids lived in Graz, G-R-A-Z, which at that time was the second largest city of Austria, but it's really sort of a large town. And my grandfather was a professor at the university there and the only Jewish professor. So on March 11th, the day that Hitler invaded Austria, in the evening, they went for my grandfather. They went to the Löwy home and took my grandfather and two of my three uncles, the other one being out of the country at that time, and put them in prison. They treated them moderately well because they still had to be a little careful about public opinion. So they were in prison for 10 weeks. My grandfather was ordered to have the Nobel Prize money, which is significant, as you may know, sent down because he had left it in Stockholm. They were released after the money arrived in the Nazi bank. They were released. My grandfather was ordered, he had to leave Austria within 2 months. My grandmother, his wife, on the other hand, was not allowed to leave because of some property that her family owned in Trieste, which you can look on the map, it's where Italy and the former Yugoslavia kind of meet. And my grandmother had what I call sort of one Italian twig in her family. And she owned some property in Trieste, and the Italians had it and the Nazis wanted it. And even though they were both Axis countries, the Italians were not giving it up. And my grandmother was caught in those crosshairs. So my grandfather had to leave. My grandmother wasn't allowed to leave. My grandfather took the Queen of Belgium up on her offer because as a Jew, A, he would need visas, and B, he'd need either a job or, you know, he had to have a destination and a reason for going there. And she saw to it that he did. There's a professorship in Brussels designed for non-Belgian visiting professors. And she made sure that my grandfather got that appointment. You may or may not have noticed on here that my grandfather shared the Nobel Prize with Sir Henry Hallett Dale, who was in England. And while my grandfather was in Belgium, Sir Henry invited my grandfather to his lab. And while he was there for some months, NYU and New York University invited my grandfather because of his Nobel Prize and the work he did to New York, and that released him. So that was a direct lifesaver to my grandfather. To my parents and me, the Queen also got us visas into Belgium. And there are parts of this story that I don't know, so I won't be able to answer some of those questions. And I suspect my parents didn't know either. We got the visa to Belgium for 3 months, and then we had to go elsewhere. And of course, it wasn't any easier then to get visas either. She got us visas or the permission or whatever to some country on the condition that we didn't actually use it. And this is where I have to ask you not to ask, because I've never quite gotten that. But we were in Belgium for 3 months safely. And then we were in France, and we stayed mostly in France. So that was an indirect saving of our lives by the Queen of Belgium, who without the Nobel Prize wouldn't have had any reason to know us, let alone.
I mean, I can tell you that when I share that with students, they're like, the Nobel Prize? Oh. And I always say, like, what? I mean, not that it was lucky that your grandfather won the prize, right, but the luck that came along with it and the connections is something that so many people didn't have available to them. Yeah. So just for everybody else, Ruth was also in England for a short time with her mother. She was in France, in the Dominican Republic, and then finally came to the United States. So again, I counted 5 different countries. But I'm wondering, and you kind of alluded to this a little bit, so thanks for making my job easier, is you said that you were like an infant to 3 years old when you were fleeing and hiding. And I had the privilege to work with you, or to meet you many times, obviously, in the museum, and to work with you throughout the past year to go through the hundreds and hundreds of documents and photos and objects that your parents saved. It is phenomenal how many documents your parents have. But I'm wondering, how did you learn about your experience as well as your family's? Is it something that was talked about while you were growing up, or something that you've had to piece together along the way?
The latter. I had to piece it together along the way. And for many years, I didn't know that. I mean, I always knew we were Jewish. I always knew we came from Europe, including me, that I was born in Europe. But that was pretty much it. And, you know, at that time, American Jews didn't want to hear about the Holocaust. Recent immigrants didn't really want to talk about it, partly not to damage their children, partly because they had to start all over creating a life here. And so they didn't want to talk about it to an audience that didn't want to hear about it. So it was silent for quite a long time. I was aware that as my parents made friends, initially almost all of them were survivors, one way or another. And so I grew up with a lot of subtle effects of it, but not really knowing much. You know, there'd be a little bit of a story here and a little bit of a story there, but they didn't really talk about it. What they did do, each of them, and I don't remember the year, but you know, we did go to New York, and we lived in New York until, literally until I was halfway through college. Mm-hmm. And my parents moved to Bethesda, Maryland. My father got a job at NIH, and my mother differently at NIH at the National Library. I never lived there, but when I went home, that's where I went after they moved there. And somewhere along the line, when I was long since out of college, I'm pretty sure, the Holocaust Museum in Washington was taking testimonies. And each of my parents did one of those. It was quite an extensive interview. And then they were on tape. And then I have a younger sister, almost 7 years younger, born in the United States in New York, oddly enough, on January 27th of 1945, The day Auschwitz was liberated. Who knew, you know what? And she was 3 weeks early. You know, there was something about that. So she transcribed those tapes. So she and I, and now all three of my daughters, have, you know, paper copies of each of those interviews. That was a good lump of information to kind of get me going on that. I'm not remembering, you know, I didn't even identify myself, and I think most people, at that, as a 2G or as a second generation, which I also am, or even as a survivor. And I do remember that my mother once said, well, we weren't survivors, we were refugees. And she made a distinction. And I can see that. I mean, our story is a lot less sort of dramatic than the story of parents who had been in the camps, or they had been in the camps and they were 10 or 12 or whatever. Mm-hmm. So somewhere along the line, it was 1995 when I first heard that there was an organization, the World Federation of, the World Federation of Jewish Child Survivors of the Holocaust and their descendants. And a survivor here, who is no longer with us, told me about this. And I went to my first conference, which happened to be in LA, 6 weeks later. And I felt I had to call them and say, you know, in two or three sentences, this is my story, do I qualify? And, you know, I qualified by age and the fact that I was living and breathing and alive. And so I learned a lot there, and it also made me want to know more about the history and about my history. And even that was not that easy, because there was a time when I was visiting in Bethesda, and my father, who had never done this before, started to talk a little bit about it. And I made the mistake of my life, because I asked him, would it be okay for me to tape you speaking? He didn't say yes or no. he got up and he left the room, which, you know, opportunity lost. 2 years later, one of my daughters, who didn't know what I've just told you, had sort of the same experience, and he let her tape it. So
there's some difference in when it's your child versus your grandchild. And I know that there is a ton of research on that, on how for some survivors, it's much easier to talk about the experiences with their grandchildren rather than their children.
On the other hand, my Nobel grandfather and his wife, who 2 years later, it's a whole bunch of other stories, also made it to New York. Mm-hmm. They were in Manhattan, we were in Queens. We went every month for a Sunday dinner. They never told me anything about it. They hardly spoke. I mean, they weren't angry or anything, but they had had a villa in Graz, and they had a gardener, a cook, and a governess. And so I always thought that, you know, they may have had four children, but they didn't really know how to be around children. Mm. You were going to say something.
No, I'm thinking you're such a reflective person. In the time that I've known you, your brain is like constantly working and reflecting on what's going on in the world around us and yourself. And I know I've talked to you about this at length, but I find that you've done such a great job at like eloquently putting it for so many people. And I know that this is going to be a question, so I'm going to answer it. I'm going to have you answer it now. But you, in your presentation summary that I've written with you, have very explicitly listed ways that your life has been affected, or ways that you have been personally affected by the Holocaust. And I'm wondering, I mean, I think you had like 5, 6, or 7 on there, but if you had wanted to highlight 1 or 2 of the ways in which you have been personally affected with either your personality, your outlook, your perspective on things.
Well, okay. 1 or 2.
I have a time limit to stick to.
I know, I do too, I suppose, and I'm letting you do it for me. Part of it is that safety, or the lack thereof, has been a huge issue in my life. I grew up a very scared little kid. My first memory is actually when I was 3 and we were in the Dominican Republic. And not so oddly, it was something that I was afraid of, that you didn't need to be afraid of. But I was afraid of the dark and of water and of most grown-ups and of success and of failure. And I was a fearful but very, very quiet little girl and big girl. I guess another part that goes with that maybe is that I was, and am now only slightly less so, pathologically obedient. You tell me the rules and I follow them. You don't tell me the rule and I still follow them. It's kind of like I need to know when, you know, what's okay and what isn't, because I was born into a world that didn't want me because I was a Jewish child. My parents did want me, don't get me wrong, but the rest of the world didn't. And I was lucky not to be one of the 1.5 million who didn't make it. But I'm not sort of a very free spirit. I'm not as gloomy pessimistic as my father, but I'm more serious than not. I have a sense of humor, but it's kind of dry. And you know, what is said of child survivors is that we basically didn't have a childhood. And while that took me a while to think, oh, really? I was 4, I was 5, I was 6, it's childhood. But what's true is that I don't, for example, know how to play, which I really felt very keenly when my grandkids were young, because I loved them dearly. I wanted to be with them. I wanted them to think I was a wonderful grandmother. And I didn't sort of really know how to be both protected and lighthearted at the same time. And I have some friends, I think of one particularly, was in a reading group, and we were talking about, oh, we should go to, and this was well before COVID. And she said, oh, let's go to the coast and play. And I was kind of, I didn't know what she meant. I didn't know what we were going to do. I don't know how adults play. So I don't know, is that one or two, or do you want more?
No, that's good. I think we're going to start to have you answer some of the questions. I have like so many questions on my list, and I can continue to talk to you forever, but I do want to have you answer some of the questions that are coming in. So Adam was wanting to know if what were some of the warning signs that your father saw?
Well, to the extent that he ever told me, Hitler came to power in 1933. The Nobel Prize was in 1936. And for those of you who are interested in how old I am, I was born in 1938. And furthermore, I was born 1 week after the invasion of Austria. We were not in Austria, we were in Czechoslovakia, but I was 1 week old. I'm sorry, tell me the question again.
It was what warning signs did your father? Yeah.
He looked around, he knew history, he knew that Bohemia, and he was part of this, was the German-speaking part of Czechoslovakia. He went to German-speaking schools, he went to the German-speaking university. Germans there were already second-class citizens in Czechoslovakia because of the first-class citizens were the Czech-speaking. And then to be a Jew was sort of the second whammy against mm-hmm. you. And he had a sense of foreboding about a lot of things. And he also knew enough of what was going on in Germany that there would be an influx again. And he just didn't believe I don't know what Hitler may have said about what he was and wasn't going to do, but my father didn't believe him.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's a question I talk about with students all the time is what are warning signs? And we often look back in history and the warning signs are so apparently obvious, but in the moment, sometimes it's hard to see those warning signs.
Yeah. He wouldn't have told you, I know what's coming and I know what day it's going to happen, but he didn't trust, there was the hate speech against Jews, hate speech by itself will rile up a population, Jewish or otherwise. If it's hate speech against Jews, the riling up looks different from the rest of the population. But he loved his country and he was very grateful for our lives here. But he always loved Czechoslovakia and acknowledged that he wasn't always very well treated.
Yeah. We have another question from Joe. And Joe, I love that you brought this up. He says, I have often heard you say that you are both a child survivor and a child of survivors. Can you help us understand the different ways in which these identities have affected you?
In 2 minutes?
Sure. Again, I'm making you do impossible tasks today.
So tell me again, child survivor and child of survivors and how they affected me differently?
Or how those identities intersected or affected you as you were growing up or again throughout your life?
Right. Well, I think the thing that came to mind first is that because of being a child survivor, I don't really know how to belong because I wasn't supposed to be here in the first place. And we didn't belong to the major population, which were the Czech-speaking Jews. I haven't told a lot of people, although that's about to change if I say it now, but at age 2, I spoke 3 languages by necessity. I don't think there are a lot of 2-year-olds in the world that have to do that. It's not because I'm that brilliant, it's because I had to. And for whatever reason of intuition or whatever a 2-year-old has, I never spoke the wrong language at the wrong time. Had I done so, it would have been a betrayal. So there's all, I think that obedience comes from being the child survivor, and some of the things I've already spoken to you about tonight do. Mm-hmm. And as far as being a second generation, well, some of the obedience comes from that too. I've done a fair amount of reading, and I've read that there are some ways in which 2G, the second generation, have a harder time, at least with aging, than the rest of the population. And I can't give you a whole list of why that's true, but if I think of the emotional complications of having survived and having successfully avoided being rounded up, being deported, having gone to the right places instead of the wrong places. And I was gonna say something and it's gone. You know, my parents were good people and they wanted a child. They married what was late for that time, and I was born 10 months later. And it was clear that they wanted a child. It wasn't clear that they, I mean, I often think of what a burden I must have been. I mean, they didn't plan for me to be a burden, but they certainly planned to have a child. But you're in flight, you're in hiding, and you have a baby here with you, and then a toddler. And then the toddler learns to speak, and you hope for another year before things get better that you won't say the wrong thing at the wrong time. And so obedience to the unspoken, kind of.
Yeah.
And, you know, I realize I'm not being quite as concrete as we both wish I were being. Probably when this program is over, I'll remember. But I remember when I was reading kids' literature, I read over and over and over again Little Women, was it Little House on the Prairie, I think it was, and Black Beauty. And what I realized later is that these were stories of close-knit families where everybody was clearly and sometimes exorbitantly loved and wanted. And that was the kind of parents I wanted, and I didn't have it.
Mm.
You know, they were not demonstrative.
They had their own traumas that they were dealing with too.
They had their own traumas and their own backgrounds.
Yeah.
My mother was one of four kids and all the others were boys, right? And mm-hmm. she had to keep up. Well, I was so obedient and self-effacing and standing back that keeping up wasn't even an issue because mm-hmm. up wasn't where I belonged. I don't know if that really answered.
It's all good. I always enjoy listening to you because you always share such like new information that I didn't know about you. So this is a really quick question.
Okay.
Elaine and Jonathan want to know what your grandfather's name was and what he won the Nobel Prize for.
Oh, okay. So his name was Otto Loewi, L-O-E-W-I. And he won the prize for literally dreaming three times, an experiment that would prove that nerve transmission is chemical. And I'll try to put that in plainer English. We have a thought that we're going to move an arm, for example. Somehow, something has to get from the brain to the muscles of the arm, right? And that goes through the nervous system. And the way the nervous system is constructed, one cell doesn't touch the other cells, it's little hairs at the end. And so there's this gap that's called a synapse. And one of the big questions of the day is how does the impulse cross all those millions of synapses? Mm-hmm. And it was thought it might be electrical, and it was thought they might actually touch and then go away. I don't know what all the thoughts, but it was also possible that it was a chemical thing. And that's what my grandfather proved. In a 1 hour experiment, when he got up in the wee hours after the third time of dreaming it, the first time he couldn't remember it, the second time he couldn't read his handwriting. And so the third time he just got up, went to the lab, did the experiment and proved that it was a chemical and that it was acetylcholine. I hope that was basic English enough to.
I understood it. So thank you. All right, Ruth. Well, I want to thank you so much for taking some time to talk with me and everyone who is in attendance tonight. I always find such value in everything that you say, and we're so grateful to have you a part of our Portland area community and Oregon community here. And at this point, it is now my pleasure to introduce Anya Kalina, the Executive Artistic Director of Portland Chamber Music, who will lead us into the musical portion of our program tonight. We are thrilled to be working with Anya and the Portland Chamber Music again, as we were fortunate to have them perform in person at the museum a little more than a year ago. We hope that you enjoy the performance.
Can't hear you.
Sorry, as you work out the technical difficulties.
I just want to tell you, I really enjoyed this conversation, Amanda.
I always enjoy speaking to you, Ruth. Thank you.
Hi friends, it's Judy Margles talking. We seem to be having a bit of technical difficulty. Hang in with us for a minute and I'm sure we're going to figure it out.
While we're hanging on, Ruth, do you want to come back on for one more question?
Yeah. Sure, am I still there?
I mean, I can hear you. If you could turn your camera back on, I'd love to see you.
There you go.
Okay. So I'm actually really interested to hear this. And sometimes the best questions are the ones that we don't think of. And it's one that kids think of or other times. So what is a really meaningful or memorable question that you've been asked in some other presentation that you give, that you've given? You've been speaking for 30 years. So what are a great question or what questions that you've been asked, and what has your answer been?
Well, yeah, I've been thinking about this and being sorry I didn't write down the questions after all those years, because it's been hard even thinking about it, you know, to come up with one. One that I found really interesting, especially if it was asked by somebody younger, like seventh or eighth grade, they'd want to know what the difference is between the Holocaust and other mass killings, is how one person put it. And of course, this was more during the time of Cambodia and the killing fields and the former Yugoslavia and so forth. And my answer comes from a time when I had the opportunity to ask Elie Wiesel in person the same question in the 80s. And then I really expanded on that. And that is, the intent of the Holocaust was to wipe out a whole culture. All the Jews in Europe, and if he had succeeded, probably on other continents until the world. And that piece, and the fact that it was state-sanctioned hatred, it was proposed by the state, it was articulated by the state, talking about Hitler and his people. That it came from the government and was aimed at promoting hatred. The other ones, Cambodia, Yugoslavia, and I don't know why I'm thinking of the others because there have been so many. Elie Wiesel described as in Rwanda, for example, the Hutus and the Tutsis. What he pointed out, which should have been obvious to me, is that once anyone from either side crossed the border into another country, they were safe. Mm. That was not true of Jews. And so what I think of it as, the other genocides are definitely genocides. I don't mean to mitigate that. They were within the context of civil wars. You know, the Hutus didn't want the Tutsis there, and the Tutsis didn't want the Hutus there, and they were fighting. And likewise, the killing fields in Cambodia. But it was not the wholesale wipeout of a whole culture or a whole population.
Thank you. And I think, you know, you just raised such an important point as we enter the next month in looking at what are the uniquenesses from each genocide, and where are the overlaps, and how do we make meaningful connections and comparisons without comparing experiences of pain? So I think that's, you know, a lot of what these kids try to understand as well, is how do we make those connections and comparisons without saying which one was worse? So thank you. All right, it sounds like we're gonna try and do this round two. So again, I hope that you enjoy the music.
Oh. Hello, we are Portland Chamber Music, a local nonprofit performing group. Our core mission is to bring classical music performances of outstanding quality to underserved communities. We've been working on the project of music and musicians of the Holocaust for several years now, trying to bring more light to the events of history that should never be forgotten. The first piece we'll be playing for you today is by James Simon, a German composer, accomplished pianist, and musicologist. He studied philosophy, loved poetry, and felt totally home with the great German musical tradition. Music was his life. Dr. Simon taught in the Conservatory of Berlin and was active as a pianist throughout his life, giving solo recitals and playing chamber music. He composed about 100 art songs, multiple chamber music pieces. His one opera published by Universal edition in Vienna, Lady in the Stone, was performed only once. Many of his larger works, including orchestral compositions, string quartets, and a cantata, remain in manuscript and have never been performed. As Jewish people in Germany were losing their freedoms, on April 4th of 1944, he was transported to Terezin ghetto. In the transport list, he was described as well-known pianist from Berlin. In Terezin, like many others, he continued to compose, perform, and give lectures. Unfortunately, none of his works from this period survived. On October 12th of 1944, he was transported to Auschwitz, and a witness remembers how the composer, seemingly unaware of what happened around him, sat on a suitcase, waiting for the train and jotting down his last musical thoughts. He died in a gas chamber shortly after his arrival. James Simon, arioso for solo cello, composed in 1929, performed by Jonah Thomas.
Thank you.
Gideon Klein was born in Moravia in 1919. His family, rooted in Jewish tradition, was also modern in outlook and supportive of culture and art. At age six, he began to study piano with the head of the local conservatory. In the fall of 1938, he was admitted to master's of the Prague Conservatory. He graduated from the master's school in 1 year, but when the Nazis closed all institutions of higher learning following their occupation of Czechoslovakia in March of 1939, he could not continue the university. During this period, Klein began to perform wildly. In 1940, he was offered a scholarship for study at the Royal Academy of Music in London. But by that time, Nazi race and emigration laws prevented his leaving the country. Jewish musicians could also no longer perform in public. Gideon tried to circumvent this for a time by appearing under a different name of Karl Franek. Until recently, it was assumed that Klein had written very little music until blossoming as a composer in Terezin. But in 1990, a locked suitcase that had been forgotten for over 50 years was found. It contained Gideon's manuscripts, evidently placed for safekeeping with a friend before Klein was sent to Terezin. It revealed earlier works of astonishing craftsmanship and maturity for someone being just 19 or 20 years old. Songs for soprano and piano, an octet for winds, large-scale pieces of string quartet, and several string duos. On December 1st of 1941, Gideon Klein, along with thousands of other Prague Jews, was deported to Terezin. He immediately became active in the camps, cultural life. Klein's composition in Terezin include chamber music for strings, choral works and piano sonata, music for theater, and a song cycle for alto and piano. In the winter of 1943, a lullaby song was performed in Terezin ghetto. An art song with a Hebrew text we will be performing for you today. Gideon Klein was sent to Auschwitz on October 1st of 1944, and from there to Fürsengruppe, a coal mining labor camp for men. He certainly received no consideration for his musical talents, but paid the ultimate price on January 27th of 1945, less than 2 months after his 25th birthday. Gideon Klein, Lullaby, performed by Anya Kalina, soprano, Regina Sadowski, violin, and Michael Leo, piano.
Thank you.
Was one of the most popular Czech composers and pianists of his time, but his death marked the almost total erasure of his work from music history. At the time of the German invasion, he had been at the high point of his career, well established and respected by the artists and composers of his day. He was one of the first European composers to begin experimenting with jazz by integrating it into traditional musical forms such as symphonies and concertos. In the winter of 1941, he was deported to Wolfsburg concentration camp in Bavaria. Although most inmates were assigned exhausting field work, the musician was spared this by a sympathetic camp commander. Nonetheless, his health was bad and quickly worsened. He died of tuberculosis in August of 1942. Erwin Schulhoff, Sonata for Solo Violin, Fourth Movement Finale, Allegro Risoluto, performed by Regina Sadowski. Olivier Messiaen was a French composer, one of the major composers of the 20th century. Messiaen was a prisoner of war in German captivity, during which time he composed his quartet for the end of time. For the four available instruments at the camp, piano, violin, cello, and clarinet. It was first performed by him and his fellow prisoners in 1941. Olivier Messiaen, Quartet for the End of Time. Fourth movement, interlude, performed by Jennifer Crockett, clarinet, Regina Sadowski, violin, and Jonathan Cheskin, cello. Smith was born in Amsterdam to a family of prosperous non-Orthodox Portuguese Jews. He studied piano and composition at the Amsterdam Conservatory and graduated in 1923 with highest honors. Attracted to the openness of French musical life, Smith moved to Paris in 1927. Even with his strong connections to French music, Smith never abandoned his ties to Holland, where his works gained in popularity and were frequently performed. In 1937, he made the fateful decision to return with his wife to Amsterdam, where he continued to compose and gave private instructions in piano and composition. With the German invasion and occupation in 1940, Jews in Netherlands were quickly subjected to Nazi racial laws. By the following year, Jews musicians were excluded from all forms of public musical life, but Smith continued to compose, completing his last known piece, the Sonata for Flute and Piano, in February of 1943. Right before being deported to Westerbork transit camp. While it is impossible to assert direct musical connections between this work and his tragic life circumstances, the deeply poignant slow middle movement of this work often has a strong emotional impact on listeners. After the arrival to Sobibor in April of 1943, Smith and his wife were murdered within days. Leo Smith, Sonata for Flute and Piano, Second Movement Lento, performed by Linda Hess, flute, and Michael Liu, piano.
Thank you. Whoa, that was beautiful. Thank you everyone for joining us this evening. I'm just gonna take a very, very brief moment, give some thank yous and a little appeal. My name's Judy Margles. I am the director at the Oregon Jewish Museum and Center for Holocaust Education. I wanna just express a really special thanks to Amanda Coven and Ruth Bolliger. What a thoughtful conversation, Ruth. It is always wonderful to hear you speak. So thank you so much for being candid and honest and kind of raw with us. Really appreciated that. Anya Kalina, who's the Executive Artistic Director of Portland Chamber Music, thank you so much for giving us this utterly gorgeous music this evening. The musicians that you just heard include Jonathan Cheskin on the cello, Jennifer Crockett on clarinet, Linda Hess on flute, Michael Liu on piano, Regina Sadowski on violin, Jonah Thomas on cello. I also want to acknowledge Nathan Crockett, who was the project videographer for the concert. We're always just thrilled to be able to partner with Jewish Family and Child Service. I just want to do another shout out for Ruth Scott and Larry Holtzman for inviting us to partner with them on this program. I do want to give a special thanks to my colleague, Gail Mandel, for her close attention to the details of the evening. She really worked on all, as you can see, how great the evening was. So thank you, Gail, for that. My most heartfelt thanks, however, really have to go to the survivors in this community who enrich our lives every day. So the piece I want to leave you with is just to make sure that we understand that we have a communal obligation to make sure that all of our survivors are cared for. As Larry said at the beginning of the program, in Portland, there are approximately 100 survivors, with 80 of them under the auspices of Jewish Family and Child Service. If I understand correctly, the youngest survivor is about 79 years old today. The oldest is 98. So for those of us who have been working with JFNCS at the museum, it's really been transformational. And I think one of the things that we've come to understand that the good work that we're able to do at the museum to educate our audiences about the history of the Holocaust, that's only part of the equation. We also have this obligation to care for those survivors who need assistance. So I do ask you this evening, I hope you're gonna join me. Please do make a gift to the Holocaust Survivor Community Fund, and you can find details of that on the Jewish Family and Child Service website. Just in closing, thank you so much for joining us. I do wanna invite everyone to join next Wednesday evening for the annual Yom HaShoah service. It's going to be led this year by the Oregon Board of Rabbis. It is by Zoom. And then the following day on Yom HaShoah, we're actually offering a modified reading of the names. We're going to do it live at the Oregon Holocaust Memorial between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m., but we're live streaming the event so everybody can watch in real time, or we'll have a recording that you can watch afterwards. You can find registration details on the museum website. Once again, thank you for joining us this evening. Good night.